Forgive me, I'll speak in English. The government may not, it goes without saying that every one of us here condemns the arrests of these activists. Why now, why these activists, and which way is it going? The government may not have declared an emergency officially, but they have declared now, I mean, it's as plain as daylight, that dissent is a crime. Okay? For the last 30 years, in fact, we have passed many laws that make an official emergency unnecessary. Right? They have now told you that dissent is a crime. They have picked up people. What is the crime of those who have been arrested? Is there a crime? My friend, the intellectual and writer Badri Raina, put it very well. He said all these activists have committed the crime of sharing knowledge of the Indian Constitution with thousands and thousands of marginalized human beings who are denied their rights under that Constitution. That is the crime that they have committed. Okay? This afternoon, the Maharashtra police chiefs held a press conference where one of the top police officers said, there is propaganda going on against the Maharashtra police to defame us. There is absolutely no possibility that anyone can discredit the Maharashtra police further than they have already done in the last 3 years. It's not possible to discredit the Maharashtra police beyond that. This gang of leaders of the police are facing fire on the floor of the High Court of Bombay, Bombay High Court, which has pulled them up for failing to make any headway in the murders of Govind Pansare and Dabolkar at a time when the Karnataka police have made significant progress in the investigation of the murder of Gauri Lankesh. Second, and this is not appearing in your media, 2 weeks ago, the anti-terrorism squad cracked a major cell, a Hindutva terror cell, and seized very, very significant weapons from them. And every day, new details are coming out, but only one or two newspapers are covering it. Okay? Every day new details are coming out that further arrests have been made, further weapons have been recovered. Those weapons were planned for attacks during the coming festival season to spark a communal conflagration, the like of which would lead to irreversible damage on the communal harmony front in Maharashtra. That is one thing. On the other hand, the Bombay court. Both these things are issues from which the Maharashtra government and police need a serious diversion. Plus the fact that the arrests are made on the same day that the Reserve Bank of India brings out its report showing you that demonetization was a fraud. So there were three major reasons for this evasion. However, it's not just evasion. There is something beyond that strategy of evasion. I think the mindset of the ruling elite of this country, I think you are seeing the birth of the state as sociopath. You inflict misery, torture, not just merely as a strategy, but because it gives you a pleasure to do so. You have to not just defeat your enemy, you have to humiliate that enemy. You have to drag them through the mud. You have to absolutely crush them, and in that triumph, you experience some high. It's the mindset of a sociopath. Okay? Further, if you look at each of these people arrested and their record, that speaks for itself. However, I said that every one of these activists knows that what they are fighting, what they are facing today, are the very things that they have been fighting against on behalf of millions of marginalized people who have been facing them for decades. They have been facing them for decades. As I said after the attack on JNU, I spoke in JNU, and my first line to my old, to my, you know, JNU friends was, welcome to the rest of the country. Yeah. In Koraput, I interview professors of chemistry who have been arrested on a charge of theft of a buffalo. 95 charges in which theft of a buffalo is one of them. That professor can hardly tell the difference between one bovine species and another. It's not his area, but he's arrested for theft of a buffalo. I asked the then Orissa, this was 4 years ago when I was rural editor of the Hindu. I asked the then Odisha DG, I think IGP or DGP, why do you do this? He said, we put multiple charges so that one of them will stick. We know that the serious charges, the court will dismiss those charges, the murder charges. So let us put something, even drunkenness, disorderly behavior, or theft of an automobile, all these kinds of charges are there. An Adivasi couple fighting against the acquisition of land by the Tatas in Kalinganagar, they had never been in a police station in their lives. They are both graduates from University of Cuttack, okay? The University of Cuttack in Odisha. After they refused to cede their land to the project, to the Kalinganagar project of the Tatas, in which protest 17 people were shot dead, those two, that couple has 91 cases against them. Cases on charges they never imagined could happen. Over the last two decades, you are watching the serious criminalization of dissent. That is the process we are living under. The criminalization of dissent. And we need to speak now against it. We need to speak at this point. My friend Selva, who introduced me, told you that I came from this city. I want to tell you, 41 years ago, during the emergency, I was general secretary of a students' union in this city. The emergency was a bad time. We all had a little trouble with it, but we were living in Chennai, in Tamil Nadu. We had a caste and class background that was some kind of insurance against atrocities. However, I think this is very important. We did not suffer, we knew what, but we got to know what was happening up in the north. We did not suffer, but it mattered to us that others did. It mattered to us because the word justice meant something to everybody, not just those denied justice. It meant something to each and every one of us. And I will also say this, scary though the emergency was, destroyed our studies and all of that, yes. But I do not remember ever, feeling the sense of intellectual intimidation that exists today in this country in the last several years. That kind of intimidation, this kind of, it doesn't matter who you are, what you are, that is now reaching the elite in a very big way. Please know this. Before the murder of Gauri Lankesh, and of the four murdered people, I knew three quite well. I knew Comrade Pansare well. I knew Professor Dabolkar. In fact, I did the spoke at the 25th anniversary of his magazine, and I knew Gauri well. I mean, we were not regularly interacting, but we'd known each other for decades. Before Gauri's murder, between 1992 and 2015, 27 journalists in this country were murdered for reasons clearly linked to their journalism. that the Committee for Protection of Journalists report, to which I wrote the introduction, will tell you. What is significant? In those 27 journalists, there was not a single big city, high profile, English language journalist. Not one. All the journalists were small town, Indian language journalists working for small publications, very vulnerable. With the killing of Gauri Lankesh, the murders entered another area. Those of us who thought we had that natural protection and insurance of our class and caste backgrounds, I have to say that the premium on that insurance just doubled. It has been made clear to us that, you know, get in line, you are also on the list. All of this has been made clear to the big city journalists. However, there are many journalists in the mainstream corporate media who are never going to face this problem because they are never allowed to say anything against the government. In the emergency, what happened was state censorship. What happened then was state censorship. And papers like the Indian Express carried blank editorials to show that they had been censored by the state. Today's media, it is self-censorship on behalf of the government and on the orders of their corporate owners. It is the corporate censorship that you are looking at. You will not even get to know through blank columns in the newspapers. The kind of attack on the independence of journalists that has come in the last few years, you can have a look at that. I mean, it's really intensified like anything. Lastly, I will say this. Speak now. Speak now. There is this incredible make-believe and pretend world in a large section of the media of these people being anti-nationals, of there being various things. Speak now, or you will be forever silenced. Thank you.